A very good afternoon to all of you, and a special good afternoon to Madhavi, who is the first one to put the good afternoon on the chat box. Now, the one thing that I'm sure we cannot trust anymore is the weather, because 5 months in a city like Bangalore, we have not had a drop of rain. It's unbelievable. But this is where it hits us directly. You know, when we say NIMBY, not in my backyard. For years, we have been talking about climate change, global warming, ecology destruction. And we were comfortable sitting here thinking nothing will happen to us. And here we are. It has already happened to us. This summer is so, so relentless. And we well-to-do people at least are sitting in our buildings under the fans or whatever it is. I can imagine the people who are out in the heat and the sun for days, weeks, months together without any relief from the hot summer. Anyway, today's topic is about building trust. And as an exercise to build that skill to know whom to trust, when to trust, and how much to trust, and in what areas to trust and what areas not to trust. I remember very long back, I had an aunt, actually she was a great aunt, I think my grandmother's something. She was married to a very, she came from a good family herself, and then was married to a person who had become a big shot. And because of that, they used to go and stay in 5-star hotels. And this lady had a habit that whenever she would stay in one of those posh hotels, she would pick up something or the other from the hotel. She would not check out without taking something which doesn't belong to her. It could be a towel, it could be a napkin, it could be a pillow cover, it could be a pen stand kept on the desk. But every time she used to take something, the people came to know there was a pattern. But they realized that she is the wife of a big shot, and we can't do anything about it. If we try to question her or something, we are going to be in deep trouble. So they had accepted it. This I came to know much later, that what they used to do is, in the room where she is checking in, they used to put all the old and frayed things, so that even if they lose that, it doesn't matter. But why I'm telling you this case is, she was otherwise 100% honest. She never cheated anybody. She would go to somebody's house, she would never pick up anything from there. She would never cheat anybody in money matters. In fact, she was a very generous person, I'm told. She used to look after all these servants and, you know, the lower class people, people who come to work in any form with her. She would be extra generous. She would give them more than what they required or what was promised to them. Why I gave you this example is to first emphasize on the fact that trust is not across the board. There are people who feel that there is nothing wrong in, let's say, cheating the income tax department. I will fudge my accounts. I will put something here and something there so that if I have to pay so much income tax, I will pay only a fraction of it and I will get away with it. The same people, if they are doing business transactions or money transactions, even when they have an opportunity to cheat one of their customers or suppliers or something, they will never do it. They'll say, no, it is against my value system. And I have asked some of these people that if you have such a value system and if you feel that, you know, taking somebody's money is not okay, why do you do it in your taxes? That is when he would tell many of them that it's okay to cheat the government. The government has got such huge funds. And anyway, they themselves misuse the funds. What money I give as tax doesn't really go to the deserving people. It goes to the corrupt officials and politicians and all that. So if I reduce what I am giving to the department, what am I doing wrong? Now, there are two ways of looking at it. One person can say, no, this person is doing something which is wrong, whether you cheat a customer or whether you cheat the income tax department. Cheating on money is cheating on money. Another person would probably agree with him and say, yeah, I also know how this government works and how there are inefficiencies and corruptions. So that is not really called cheating. So that is why I thought I will help you to first understand that nobody is 100% trustworthy. And sometimes we make this mistake. If we really get to like a person, and if you're very impressed with that person, and if we feel that this person is highly respectable and does things in a fantastic manner, everything he does is so perfect, we think we can trust him with anything and everything. And that is where we make the fundamental mistake. There will be friends who will be get very close to each other. There will be occasions when they go out and person A will insist on paying the bill in the restaurant or paying for the cab or auto or whatever it is. He'll be so extra nice to his friend that person B will start thinking that A is such a trustworthy, such a reliable, such a true friend. Now, one fine day, B has a very urgent need of some 10,000 rupees or whatever. And he goes to A and says, can you give me this money? I'll return it to you on Monday. And A says, no, I don't believe in taking money or giving money to friends. I don't borrow and I don't give loans. Sorry, that's it. And B gets the shock of his life. He says he doesn't trust me with 10,000 rupees. We've been friends for so long. He knows everything about me. We have been always on the nice side. What is wrong with him? Now, the point here was, did B ever ask A, do you give loans or do you take loans? Do you do money transactions with your friends? All he needed to do when there was no need to ask him. And A would have said, no, I don't. And that's it. You would know that this is the aspect of the person. Now, I can go on and on reeling on these things. That whenever you have to trust, I think, other than maybe God Almighty, you can put your 100% faith in him and you can trust him. But even there, remember, you work very hard to get something. You pray continuously to God that, see, I'm a deserving person. I'm working hard for this. So please see to it that I'm not cheated or I'm not let down and I get the reward of the hard work that I'm putting. Finally, you don't get it. Suddenly, somebody cheats you. Now, has God Almighty let you down? Do you lose faith and trust? One person would say, yes, I will never pray to God. Another person will say, maybe God had his reasons why I was let down in this transaction. I will not question God. I will continue to have my trust in God and pray to him, etc. So this is how the whole range is. In many cases, we do have to trust because we do not know anything. For example, if you have an automobile or a two-wheeler, you put petrol in it. It's a liquid, you can see it. Now somebody tells you, when you put petrol in this vehicle, the vehicle's engine will start and will take you wherever you want. Now how do you get convinced? How do you know that it will happen? Petrol is expensive. I put 10 liters of petrol and I spent 1,000 rupees. Will the vehicle actually take me? You say, yes, I have that trust in my vehicle. It will take me. Anything of that nature. You fall sick or somebody close to you falls sick. And doctors say that this person needs surgery. Somebody recommends such and such surgeon can do the surgery. Now, you don't know anything about medical matters, leave alone about surgery. How do you trust that surgeon and say, okay, I'm putting the life of my loved one in your hands and giving you a huge amount of money also. And I trust that you will do the needful and my loved one will get well. So there are areas where we have no choice but to trust. But today I wanted to talk about trusting when it comes to interpersonal relationships. That is where we get into trouble. It ranges from your most close persons in your intimate circle to maybe some outsiders with whom you do one odd, money transaction. You may need to get some carpentry work done and you get a carpenter. And that carpenter says, give me 2,000 rupees. I have to go and get the materials. Then I'll come and do your work. You give him that 2,000 rupees and he disappears. You find that his phone has been switched off. You don't know his address. You've lost that money. It could even happen with a domestic servant who's been working with you for a long time. Very hardworking, very committed, very sincere. One fine day, she asks you for a huge loan. And she says, every month you can deduct so much from my salary. She's already been working with you for years. And you give her that loan and you never see her again. Now, why do such things happen? Because we have not acquired that skill of whom to trust, how to trust, and how much to trust. So let me assure you that this is a skill which we can build up. If we just blindly keep either trusting people or the opposite, not trusting anybody. One domestic servant took a loan from me and disappeared. Next time I have a domestic servant, however good she is, however hardworking and committed she is, even if she asks for a very small loan, I'm not going to give it to her. People say, I don't trust friends. I don't trust relatives. In the intimate circle, a man may say, I am earning the money. I don't trust my wife. I will do the purchasing and expenses myself. I won't give her the money. I don't know how she will deal with the money and what will she do. A parent will say, I don't trust my child with money. I will go with my child and buy whatever he or she needs, but I will not give money in my child's hand. All these things, whether they go to one extreme or the other extreme, are primarily because we are not developing, sharpening that skill called how to know whom to trust, when to trust, and how much to trust. So what I did was, as I do generally, I built it up in some bullet form. I said, okay, let me give it to you in a concise manner so that maybe you can also remember. Maybe you can take a screenshot or whatever it is, or in the end, Anis will play it up once more for you so that you can jot it down or whatever way it is. So I made this and Anis made it into a very nice PPT. Here it is for you. That is building the trust, how to know whom to trust, when to trust, and how much to trust. Somebody is trustworthy if the first point in that is they are consistent. Please remember that consistent people are the most trustworthy people. Those who are not consistent, they keep changing their habits, their behaviors, their commitments. Please be aware of them. They show compassion and humility. They care for you or they care for other human beings. If you find somebody with these qualities, the next is that they respect boundaries. They know how much to go deeper in and how much not to. They know how much to respect you, whether it's your time or your money or whatever it is. They respect boundaries. They say, okay, I know this will hurt you or this will upset you or this you will not approve. I will not get into the thing. The next is they compromise and don't expect something for nothing. People who come to you and make demands without giving you something in return. And when I say giving, it's not just in material terms or money terms. The trustworthy people are those who understand that to build trust, I have to give first and then get. So they compromise on these things. The other thing is very, very simple, but equally important. They are relaxed. They are not shifty-eyed. They are not running from here and there. They are not caught up in something and getting worked up about something. And equally important, they make you relaxed in their presence when they are with you. They don't, you know, keep changing their moods and things like that. They are relaxed and they make you relaxed. And they value your time. They don't impose unnecessarily on your time. And they show gratitude. Whenever you do something nice to them, they express gratitude. They don't take it for granted. They make it a point to convey to you that I am thankful that you have done this very small gesture, but this is what I am happy about. These are the basic foundations which show us how to determine whether a person is trustworthy in general. Now, I would like to take it one step beyond that. Just because a person fits into all seven parameters, it does not mean you can trust the person unconditionally and to an unlimited extent. No. The best way to find out whether this person is trustworthy in a particular area or not is to try him out. If it is money matters, try it out with such a small amount of money that even if you lose it, it doesn't matter. If it is commitment and living up to the word, try out the person in a small occasion where even if the person lets you down, it doesn't really hurt you. If it comes to a person who is gossiping or not maintaining confidentiality, say something which is so small that it doesn't hurt you and see whether that person's hold on. So essentially, I would say that you should try out whenever you find somebody, be it a, you know, professional acquaintance like a carpenter or a shopkeeper or auto driver, or it is somebody who is a close friend of yours or a relative of yours, coming down right to the intimate circle. Can I trust my father in these matters? Can I trust my spouse in those matters? Can I trust my child in these matters? Then I would like to present to you effective ways to build trust, to have a trustworthy relationship between the two of you. These are also very simple 7 points. Firstly, value long-term relationships. Have long-term thinking. A lot of people get carried away by somebody who comes, you know, like a typhoon. I'll get this for you. I'll do that for you. I can do this for you. I can help you in this. I can get that done for you. Don't get sucked into that typhoon. Tell that person, okay, you do something small for me. We'll see later. No, I can do something big for you. I can get this done. No, thank you. I hardly know this person. I'm not going to allow this person to take me for granted and do favors so that I start trusting him and then I lose up. Second is be honest. You be honest and the chances of the other person being honest really increase. If you build up the habit where you say, regardless of what the others may be doing, I am not going to be dishonest in any matters. I'm going to be transparent. And I am going to honor my commitments. You should honor your commitments. When you give your word, it can be a very small thing. That in the evening, I will meet you at the restaurant or I will meet you at the gate at 5 o'clock. 5 o'clock, does not mean 5:10 or 5:20. It should be 5 o'clock. And in the extreme case where you are not, you should admit when you are wrong. I am extremely sorry. I committed to you for 5 o'clock and I took a nap and I went to sleep. Person may be offended. What is this? You are just happily sleeping and I was waiting for you outside in the sun. Yes, I know you are. I admit that I was wrong. Along with that comes this factor that you need to communicate effectively. Sometimes people don't understand what we are saying. Communication, I have spoken about it so many times. Communication is complete only when the receiver has actually heard, listened, and comprehended. So make sure that you communicate effectively. I will meet you at 5 o'clock at gate number 1, behind the gate or outside the gate. In case I get delayed, please hold on and wait there. Whenever I'm free, within few minutes, I will be there. Whatever you have to do, please communicate effectively. And in the same breath, I would say, be helpful to others. In simple matters, need not be financial. When you are helpful to somebody, you have this advantage that your self-esteem goes up. I don't care if the other person is helpful or not. I don't care whether the other person does good things to me or not. I will do it not as a favor to the other person, but for my own self-satisfaction. And that has to be again expressed, communicated. Show people that you care. Sometimes we feel it is very hypocritical to say, yes, I like you for this, or I am willing to do this favor for you, or I feel nice about you or something. Some of us sometimes are so quick at criticizing, but so hesitant in praising. Communicating my care for you for genuine reason and explain why I am caring for you. What are those qualities in you that makes me care for you? That's how it goes. If you can do that, these are 7 very simple points which help you to understand how you can build trust. Trust is always two ways. So when you build trust, chances of the other person trusting you are higher. At the same time, remember the proverb which says, do unto others what you would like them to do to you. I don't agree with it. Because the other's needs are different and your needs are different. So just because you are good, just because you are reliable, just because you are trustworthy, don't take it for granted that the other person is also going to be trustworthy. In fact, there's a very simple message which I would like to give you as a word of caution. We are most jealous of those who help us. Why, how, we'll discuss it some other day. But just keep it in mind that when you are helping somebody, when you are caring for somebody, when you are doing things to reinforce your trustworthiness, don't take it for granted that it will happen from the other side also. Basically, I would recommend that you build up a situation where you don't unnecessarily have to trust others. Take money matters. There are 100% trustworthy banks which are backed up by the guarantee of the Reserve Bank. You can put your money in the bank and you know nothing will happen to it. But so many people, what do? They go into these fly-by-night operators who say, we'll give you much more money than the banks give you. We'll give you this dividend, we'll give you that benefits, we'll give you this and that. And initially, when you put a small amount of money, they do give you. And your trust gets reinforced. You say, yeah, I had put in 1,000 rupees and I got back 1,500. See how good it is. The next time you put in 1 lakh rupees, you're not going to get back anything at all from them. So understand to what extent you need to trust people and try them out at every point and at every stage. That's again another proverb which I always, remind people, forgive, but do not forget. The old proverb says, forgive and forget. I tell the other one, forgive, but do not forget. I have been cheated. I have been let down. I have been disappointed by somebody because I trusted that person. Okay, I've forgiven the person. It wasn't such a great deal. I can let go of whatever I lost out in that interaction with that person. So I will let go, but I am not going to forget. And that is something which you have to understand what I started with initially and what I would like to reinforce to you, that almost every person that I've come across is 100% trustworthy in certain matters and not at all trustworthy in certain other matters. I've given you a couple of examples, but I would like to reinforce this to you. Please think, anybody who is close to you, anybody whom you care for, or anybody who is important in your life, make a list of the areas in which the person is trustworthy and the areas in which you have not yet tested out. So you do not know whether the person is trustworthy or not. If you have not had any financial transaction with a close friend, be careful. Just because he's a close friend, he's always stood by you. When your mother fell sick, he rushed around, got her to the hospital, stayed overnight with her. Then he did this for you and he did that for you. All that was there. But you trust him with money and he can cheat you. So it does not mean that because a person is trustworthy in one area, he'll be trustworthy in another area. In counseling, I encounter so many situations of people, particularly, when they are hurt by their near and dear. A spouse finds that the spouse has been cheating on them. And the person gets shocked. But did you ever contemplate? Did you even think that this is possible? Did you try out that person for fidelity? No, you took it for granted. Because in all other areas, the person was completely trustworthy, but it doesn't work that way. So if you want to build up this skill and if you want to ensure that you trust the right people to the right extent, on the right occasions and in the right areas, please start thinking, whatever transaction you are having with a particular person, which are the areas in which the person is trustworthy? And I have tried out that person and I can say for sure that this person is reliable. And which are the areas in which this person has not been tried out? I'm not saying that the person is non-trustworthy, but I've not tried out that person. So I will be careful. I will take small, one by one steps to check and see whether that person is being trustworthy in that or not. And that, if you can do, all your interactions, your interpersonal relationships, and everything will go fine. So that is what I wanted to convey to you. Meera is here to quickly update you on what's happening in Banjara, and I shall be back within no time.
Good afternoon, everyone. So today's topic is so interesting, building trust. And this topic is quite intriguing because, you're so confused who, what, when, how to trust. So having said that, we just completed our Youngs and Blossoms camp yesterday. And it was amazing because children were gadget free. And for those 2 hours, only activities they did. And it was an amazing experience to see children out there, showing their talent. And we also have our DCS admissions open. And if you are somebody who wants to know how to be consistent, how to respect boundaries, and, how to just be there for people. And just, you know, if you are somebody who people come to and think that you are trustworthy so that they can share their problems with you, and you know, you're somebody who's listening to everybody and you feel that yes, I can do this, then our DCS offline classroom course is starting now in June. In fact, we very proudly are going to be signing off this year's batch. They've already finished their graduation. Now they are going to go. We are having the convocation soon. So you can become a certified counselor, no theory, no exams. And it is so, easily spread across the week that it can be at your convenient batch timings. And you can learn from the best in the field. Dr. Ali is there to guide you through this. It is his brainchild. And we have good job opportunities. And it's a very meaningful career. And for somebody who people trust a lot, this is something you should look at. So having said that, over to Dr. Ali.
Yes, I'm back. And I already see quite a few comments and questions. Anis will put them up one by one. And I will give you my comments, which I always do with the disclaimer that I'm not a guru, I'm not a master, I'm not an expert. It's just that I learn from people like you. You know, whenever you interact with me, whenever you share with me, there's always something to learn about human behavior and relationships and emotions. So based on those experiences, I respond. You can form your own opinion. You can change your thinking, or you can have your own way of thinking. Let's start as usual with Surekha, who has been a very, very dear friend and who's a very effective and very efficient counselor in her own right. Surekha says, rebuilding trust is a lot like the grieving process. Growing around that betrayal is hard and requires a lot of trust in oneself that says, I can handle it if he goofs up again, because I am believing and betting on myself, not on him. Very well said, Surekha. Trust in yourself first. People who don't trust themselves inevitably land up trusting others and getting hurt by that process. So I am there. I have done what I want and I will decide. And like Surekha said, it's like the grieving process. If you have been let down by being trusting somebody, you have to build it back. You can't just generalize and say, from now on, I'm not going to trust anybody. I'm not going to invest my money in anything, or I'm not going to build relationships or friendships, or I'm not going to have any intimate relationship. That's a very defeatist way of doing things. Okay. Then we have Surekha again saying, one of the fastest ways to restore trust is to make and keep commitments. Very well said and very true. Even very small commitments to ourselves and to others. Yes, that's a very fine way of putting it, Surekha. Commitment to myself. If I value myself and if I, you know, adhere to commitments which I have made to myself, it becomes a habit and I, you know, increase my commitments and follow through the commitments to others. There are no moral shortcuts in the game of trust. Absolutely right. You cannot bend, you know, trust or values or principles. Either you are being honest or you are not being honest. There is no such thing as saying, I am almost honest. So keep that in mind. Build trust in yourself and slowly start building trust in those who are trustworthy. Sharayu says, all the way from Dharwad, skill of building trust most often refines our instincts. Yes, that's something which, thank you for pointing that out, Sharayu. Instinct, gut feeling, intuition. These are things which I give a lot of emphasis to. And when it comes to the topic of today, that is building trust, please do go by your instinct. There are people who say, I don't know, I have been talking to this person, but somewhere my gut feeling says he's not trustworthy. Listen to your instinct and your intuition. Don't take a chance. Hold on. Check and test that person out before you go ahead and trust him. Right, then we have Vinita. Trust does not happen overnight. Very true. It requires a lot of efforts from both ends. Personally, I'm not able to trust a person once it's broken. It's very challenging. No harm, Vinita. If somebody has betrayed your trust, and if you take a decision saying, I'm never going to trust this person, you have a right to do that. As long as what I mentioned earlier, you forgive him. You don't hold it as a grudge inside you, which pains you more than it pains the other person. So you say, yes, I think to some extent I was naive or I was stupid to trust this person. This person let me down. Now I'm going to forgive this person. I'm not going to allow this person to come into my mind and disturb my thoughts and my emotions. At the same time, I would rather not trust this person at all. Keep a distance from that person, maybe be civil to the person or maybe cut off from the person. But next time I'm not going to give a chance to this person. You have a right to do that, absolutely right. Surekha says, how can we build trust if it is repeatedly violated? Answer is simple, Surekha, you can't. There are people who are, for example, compulsive liars. There are people who constantly misuse people's trust. There are people who, you know, look for innocent and naive people who are so, you know, simple-minded that you can easily win their trust and then let them down. Be aware of such people. And if you have been repeatedly violated by somebody, whoever it may be a person very close to you, tell yourself that in this area where my trust has been let down, I am not going to expose myself to this person. I'm not even going to make an attempt to try to build back that trust. I have other people in my life. All of us have. Just because one person has repeatedly violated my trust, I don't have to stick around. I can continue to have a relationship with that person, but keeping a very clear boundary and a wall, saying in this area, I'm not going to allow you to intrude into my life and to let me down if I trust you. Mamta says, building trust with friends and family is easy since we know them. But when we try to trust someone whom we don't know much, like acquaintance, bit difficulty, yes. As you say, sometimes we need to go with our basic instincts. Basic instincts is the second step, Mamta. The first step is, as I said, evaluate the person by the points which I gave you, the 7 points that I gave you. Does that person fit into those, if not 7, 6, 5, 4 of those points? So I'm going to start my interaction with checking that person out on these areas. Once I do that, if I feel that I have to interact or communicate or, you know, get involved with that person at a deeper level where trust is involved, I would test the waters by doing a small transaction with that person and checking out whether that person is trustworthy or not. And while I do that, I go by my instinct. I go by my sixth sense or the gut feeling, as they say. If that is giving me warnings, then it is better not to interact or trust that person. Go move on to somebody else. Pratiksha says, consistency results in trust. Yes, very true. Maintaining consistency and being persistent is the hard part, but the only way to build trust. Yes, this is the same thing Mamta also said, that it takes time, it takes effort. You can't build up trust with an outsider so easily just because he's your neighbor or he's somebody with whom you do some business transactions or whatever it is. I remember in the good old days, there used to be this Archie's poster, which some shopkeepers used to put up saying that, I give you credit, you no pay. I get mad. I no give credit, you get mad. Better you get mad. So I would not like to give credit to somebody till I am very sure that this person is credit worthy or trustworthy. Madhavi says, for me, trust is something I trust myself. Yes, that's what we have been saying. Know that. Build a trust in yourself. Build your self-esteem. Be confident that you know how to handle people. Wherever you have doubts, try out people. Be sure that, yes, what I'm doing is right. I'm not going to get cheated by somebody. I'm not going to succumb to somebody who is flattering me or saying nice things about me and, you know, promising me the moon and all that. That comes if I trust myself to be complete within myself. Gayatri says, if one is repeatedly let down, then we have to work on our self-compassion. Very true. If you are repeatedly let down, there's something wrong with you. You have not built that skill. There's no point in going on and on complaining, A let me down, B let me down, C let me down, or A has let me down 5 times or whatever. It is, don't waste your time doing that. If you find that you have been repeatedly let down either by one person or different persons at different times, that means somewhere your skill is lacking. You have to work on yourself. Surekha says, we may be deceived if we trust too much, but we will live in torment if we don't trust enough. Yes, it's a very fine balance, as I'm sure you know, Surekha. We have to, and as I said, sometimes you have to take some, you know, steps where you know that, okay, I'm taking a chance. It has happened to me. Some people whom I knew for a long time, you know, they asked me for something. I had a doubt, but I said, okay, the worst that will happen is I will lose that money or that thing. It's okay. I've known this person for a long time. If he cheats me and goes off with it, so be it. I've done it. Sometimes my trust has been upheld. Sometimes my trust has been let down. But I've never felt bad because I did a calculated decision that I am writing off this thing which I am giving to this person, right? Okay. We have Roshan saying, when you trust yourself, you can trust others. Very true. To build trust in yourself and others, do everything with a good heart and expect nothing in return, and you will never be disappointed. Very nice way of putting it, that when you don't have expectations, you will not be disappointed. I am providing something to this neighbor or this friend or this relative of mine, but I do not have expectations. So I'm not going to get disappointed. And if the person reciprocates, I'm going to feel very happy that the person reciprocated to me, right? Yes, Shobha says, my daughter booked some food from a nearby restaurant in Germany. While she is eating paneer and roti, she found a chicken piece. As she is a vegetarian, she felt betrayed from the restaurant. She told me that she had lost trust. So she lost interest in eating food. So trust is important. Yes, Shobha, but I would like you to tell your daughter that one incident should not be used for such an important thing as losing interest in food. It is one restaurant, one particular cook or one particular waiter who did this either knowingly or unknowingly. Obviously, he did it unknowingly. He didn't realize what has happened in that particular dish or whatever it is. One is, of course, to talk it over with the person concerned. That I had ordered a vegetarian dish. I am a strict vegetarian. I trusted you. I thought you will also respect my wishes. And comfortably, I started eating it. But when I realized that there is a chicken piece, I felt very distressed. I felt very disappointed with what you have done. What do you have to say about yourself? Listen to them. If they have an answer which is convincing, then you can trust the same person. If they do not have an answer that is convincing, make up your mind that I will never go back to that restaurant, but I will go to another restaurant and I will tell them that I've had a bad experience. So now I'm bringing my trust to you and I'm going to order food your place. Are you going to make sure that such a mistake does not happen? They will obviously be very careful. You are their customer. So instead of losing interest in food, there are other ways and means of doing it, which I think you as a mother can slowly imbibe into your daughter. Surekha says, when you make a promise, you build hope. Yes, very true. And when you keep a promise, you build trust. Very well said. Very well said. That making a commitment gives that hope to the person. And if that hope is let down, then the person feels that you're not trustworthy. But when you keep your promise, you build that trust. I think we could all keep this as a slogan for ourselves. Roshan says, I trust myself, so I attract people of my character and enjoy being their friend. Yes, a lot of wise people have said, you are what your friends are. So many people have said, show me 5 friends of a person and I'll tell you his character. So what company you keep, whom do you interact with, whom do you trust, whom do you have close intimacy or interactions with is a reflection of yourself. Recently in Mysore, there was this 90-year-old gentleman who runs the oldest, you know, pub there in Mysore, Mr. Ponanna. And he said something very interesting. He said, when you describe another person, you are describing yourself. Why? Because we select those areas which are important to us. If I describe the physical attributes of the person, then I give importance to physical attributes. If I give importance to his financial dealing, then I give importance to it. Such a wonderful thing that gentleman was speaking. Just casually, we were there in the restaurant. He said that to us. Surekha says, a marriage without trust is like a car without gas. True. You can stay in it as long as you want to, but it won't take you anywhere. Those of you who have done DCS and have attended the marriage session, which I have been taking every year, I have told you that a close relationship like marriage is dependent on 4 pillars. It starts with good communication. It moves on to respecting the differences between each other. And then it moves on to trust. And if the trust is high, it leads to a lifelong commitment. This is what we need to understand. That's one of the reasons why I also give so much importance to trust in any close relationship, be it a marriage, be it a parent-child, or be it best friends, or whatever it is. So these are such wonderful things. Roshan also says, one security guard told me that God has stamped my face with trust. What a wonderful feeling when you are trusted. Brought up by my poor father with rich values. Today I'm reaping benefits out of this virtue. Very true, very true. There's a joy in leading a life which makes you trustworthy and selecting people who are in turn trustworthy and building long-term relationships with them. That is what we need to do. It's an ongoing process. It is a skill that we can sharpen on a continuous basis. Please keep working on it. It will enrich your life and it will supplement so many other aspects of your life which you are trying to improve. So with that, I will sign off. We will meet again next Saturday. Anis will tell you the topic and I will be there next Saturday to talk to you about, am I happy in my comfort zone? Please think it over. And as I always request you, if you have any views or points on it, do let me know before 27th so that I can incorporate on it, or we can have it in the interaction session in the second half. So thank you and bye-bye.